art of communication is a language of leadership. A very pleasant evening to one and all present here. I, Kiran Shah, student of MBA, Hospital and Healthcare Management, would like to take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Colonel Ajay Gangoli. I request, sir, to kindly grace the dais. Colonel Ajay Gangoli, Group Medical Director, Apollo Health and Lifestyle Limited, qualified in Masters of Business Administration with specialization in hospital management as well as an additional degree in hospital administration. Sir has served as a medical officer, an assistant director, medical services, defense medical services, and was the medical superintendent at Jaslok Hospital and Research Institute, Mumbai. He has also served in HN Reliance Foundation Hospital, Mumbai, and is presently the Director of Medical Services, Apollo Health and Lifestyle Limited, Hyderabad. I now request Colonel Ajay Gangoli, sir, to address the gathering.
Very interesting listening to your talk. And actually, even Simarjeet, a lot of things I think that we still need to work on. You spoke about the opportunities and things like that. Yes, there are challenges, there are opportunities. Strategically, I think we do face challenges in the manpower. And I think that's a big thing that is really affecting us. The HR person who was here a little while back also did speak about things which were extremely interesting. And that's something I think in hospitals that we've been facing this for quite a few years. Okay, I'm I was so kindly introduced, Dr. Ajay Gangoli, working with Apollo Health and Lifestyle. We got 8 verticals under us, 2 sets of hospitals, 3 sets of clinics, a diagnostics, and a fertility. Next. Can I do it? Yes. I got a very interesting topic on communication, something that is looked at nowadays as very critical in healthcare. There are a lot of studies, so I'll just take you through quickly through some things that are very basic, that are not really related to healthcare. And then we'll jump to where the relevance is in healthcare. So we all know why we communicate. We try to inform, to influence, to change, to motivate, to express, and to have relationships. We know the types of communications: verbal, paraverbal, non-verbal. Can I have that in front? My laptop. What I'm now doing is try to communicate more with y'all so that I can see y'all while I talk. Okay, so we have the components of communication, which are verbal messages, paraverbal, nonverbal. And of course, these are used to send and receive messages. We quickly go through the methods of communication: in person, telephone, radio, and the nonverbals in written and in body language. Go through the types of communication styles. I'm going through this a little quickly because I think this is something that everybody should know, has already gone through at some point or the other. So types of communication styles: direct and indirect. Oh, sorry. And of course, why is it important to communicate effectively? The barriers of effective communication: temperaments, opinions, beliefs, personalities. Verbal barriers: and of course, the famous quote from a America again, praise in public and criticize in private. Barriers non-verbal. And the 5 W's of effective communication: who, when, what, which, and what effect. The pillars of effective communication: attention, liking, comprehension, remembering, and action. Just a few tools: effective verbal messages, brief, succinct, organized, jargon-free, and do not create resistance. Non-verbal messages: please do not underestimate its power. And always remember, you're continuously communicating, whether it's intentional or not. So what does a body language show? A little slide for perusal. Can I go ahead? Just quickly run through some. Now, of course, paraverbal messages of where the emphasis can mean a lot. With communication, we obviously have effective listening. The key to listening is listening more to the meaning than to the words. Effective listening, which is a combination of hearing, a desire to understand, attitude of respect and acceptance, and a willingness to see things from another's viewpoint. Obviously, it requires a high level of concentration energy, putting aside our own feelings, suspended judgment, and allowing for information valuable, gaining information that is valuable to understanding. Nonverbal skills: giving attention, being aware of the nonverbal messages, paying attention to the words and feelings, and using reflective tools. I think this is very common material, so I'm quickly skipping through this. What is effective communication? Two-way, involves active listening, reflects the accountability of the speaker and the listener, it utilizes feedback, free of stress, and it is clear to all concerned. This is something that I want to share all, because ultimately effective communication does very often involve management change. A simple principle: if you're going to have any change of management, needs the visions, needs the skills, needs the incentives, needs the resources, and needs the action plan. When all these little things are in place, that's when change occurs. I don't know if y'all have read this. Dr. Rajiv was talking about research. This is something that was written, a theory of healthcare outcomes measurement, which was done by a person called Donna Badian in Chicago in 1966. It was the basis of evaluating of how healthcare delivered something, of how healthcare outcomes were measured. And for close to 45, 50 years, this remained the standard benchmark or method to analyze how healthcare was delivered. In 2008, the University of Chicago again did a study, and they changed the principles which Donna Badian had laid down slightly. And I think a very common thread has been running through a lot of the other speakers I heard today. So ultimately, you have three main pillars of healthcare. You have the management, which is, I think, where all of us are. Some of us already doing it. Some of you us are future leaders in healthcare. You have the clinicians, in which I'm including all clinical workers, whether they're nurses, technicians, paramedical staff, anybody who is in direct contact and taking care of a patient. And of course, the patient himself or herself. Ultimately, the relationship between all three of them is where the healthcare outcome is impacted, the healthcare outcome is delivered, and healthcare outcome can be recognized, analyzed, and then possibly at some point graded. What I would like you all to see is that, to some extent, communication forms a key component in all these relationships. And until communication is taken care of everywhere. So while in here, most people look at communication as a key region for the doctor or the clinical workers and the patients, I feel it's something that impacts all three pillars. And if it doesn't work out there, ultimately you don't get great outcomes in how care is delivered. From this, we'll just go to quickly as to how patients evaluate healthcare. Patients evaluate healthcare a lot. They look at a procedural fairness. They will look at interactive fairness, and they will look at distributive or outcome fairness. So it all comes down to meeting a patient's expectations. This is a little difficult to understand, because every patient is slightly different. But finding the satisfactory methods may involve a little trial and error on the organization's part. Something in healthcare which we don't really do for service recovery. This is the Starbucks model. You'll have all, I think, read Maslow's somewhere or the other. So this is a little take on that, on service recovery. And communication plays a key part in service recovery. You can have a look at the Starbucks model, and this is something that a lot of healthcare companies don't actually pay attention to as to how you will deal with dealing. So fine, you do know that when you deliver healthcare, a lot of things will not work out the way they were supposed to. We will have complications, we will have untoward events. You all have heard about, must have studied about medication errors or complications or unexpected deaths or maybe cases which come under the sphere of medical negligence. But there's always something that we can do to mitigate whatever risks or effects happen. So from here, we come down to something that, what are the essentials for patients? So patients do need to know what they're suffering from. They do need to know what the treatment options are. And they do need to know what is the best course of treatment for them and why. This was a little study, I think, done in the US. I think Paladina Healthcare did that. And I think in Brazil also, they've done the same thing. Most initial visits are largely informational. Yet very often, we tend to have this habit of treating it like an acute care visit. The US average is 16.3 minutes for the first contact. I do know 30 years ago, when I was in Jalandhar looking at patients, we used to try to do it in 30 seconds. So we had this technique, you know, when the patient starts talking, you ask them to open their mouth to look at their throats. By the time they close their mouth, you got the prescription ready. So what we generally find is that patients are given an average of 20 seconds to tell their story before they are interrupted. What is also noticed is that when uninterrupted, most patients finish their story in about 60 to 80 seconds. Then other thing is, for the same set of patient characteristics, most physicians vary reviews from anywhere between 4 to 20 weeks. And what is actually, I would consider it heartening for the healthcare industry, that paramedical staff are generally more adherent, more likely to adhere to protocols. What was significant in the Palladino study was that for pediatric patients, just listening to them generally ended up in a 50 to 60% reduction in an ER visit. So wherever there are places where actually they have managed care, which is where the US system is, this is a significant reduction in cost, both for the patient and for the organization. Why does this often happen? This often happens due to a problem of low health literacy. Now, please do not confuse low health literacy with the literacy standard of the patient. So when you're talking of low health literacy, it's the ability of the patient to read, to understand, and to act on health information. The chances are that a lot of your patients will be suffering from low health literacy. And one of our greatest contributors to low health literacy is actually Dr. Google. What patients also generally do, and since now we have seen, we spoke about the increasing demographics of the Indian population, most of our patients are likely to be graduates. And being graduates, what most educated people do is they tend to mask their not understanding an issue in various ways. They are often hesitant or maybe ashamed to some level to actually say that they've not understood something that they're trying to explain. And unfortunately, most healthcare professionals, whether it's the doctors or nurses, we do tend to use a lot of jargon in trying to explain. And you're trying to use jargon to explain to people who don't understand. And then we go back to this problem of health literacy, and it obviously goes back to non-compliance with treatment protocols. This is what a lot of patients use to cope with low literacy. They ask other patients, they ask help from other staff, they will observe and copy, and they will bring someone who they think is more literate or will more likely understand what is being told. So who is at risk for low literacy? It can be anyone, regardless of age, race, education, income, or social class. These are just some slides on how low literacy actually negatively impacts health outcomes. They're likely not to comply with treatment. They're likely to make more medication errors. They fail to recognize a problem when it is serious. They are likely to be hospitalized for longer periods. In fact, I think the statistics show about 2 to 3 days extra length of stay just because they don't understand what is to be done. And they're very often going to take longer to reach when acute care is required. They averaged 6% more hospital visits, had fewer doctor visits, but significantly used more hospital resources. In today's strategy talk, we talked about it, how to make the system more efficient. And here you have a group of people who actually don't need too much attention, but possibly because of the lack of ability to explain are likely to cost you more. You cannot charge them more, but they're going to cost you more. So what are your implications? Your implications are poor outcomes, underutilization of preventive services, overutilization of your IP services, unnecessary expenditures, limited effectiveness, giving rise to more complaints, needless suffering, higher dissatisfactions, and at the end of the day, higher providers' frustration. So we try and find a solution for this. There's various ways to deal with how you can do that. I'll just quickly go through this. A little information on sugar. These are things actually in the Apollo sugar clinics which we've been trying to do, that we have found substantial improvement. You know, diabetes is a major burden in India. And in Apollo Sugar, we've been following up on patients now for about 2 years. We have found a significant improvement in patients if they comply with the treatment. It takes a lot of time for getting them to comply, but when they do, it has significantly improved the way, literally their quality of life. What we do find is it takes a lot of time to explain to them as to why they should comply. So this is what we have. 80% of patients normally forget what the doctor tells them as soon as they leave the office. 50% of what they do recollect is recollect incorrectly. A lot of patients feel shame around the fact that they cannot recollect things correctly. And it all results in, of course, poor compliance. So some of the best solutions, maybe asking them what they know, get to the point quickly, and ask them maybe problem solving as soon as they come. And like I said, avoiding jargon. Most patients have trouble understanding, and when explained with simpler words, they generally do better. So this is what we come down to. I think this started in the US, but this is again being done in the NHS. It's an Ask Me 3 program. It's available on the net for everybody to see. So what all healthcare providers want patients to know is all they can about their condition, why it is important for them, and what they need to prevent or keep it under control. So it just promotes three simple but essential questions. What is my main problem? What do I need to do about it? And why is it important for me to do this? From Apollo, what we're trying to do is, while this was started as a patient advocacy program, what we are trying to do is we're trying to use it as a tool for our doctors and nurses to explain to patients better. What we subsequently do plan to roll out is possibly the next year or so, once our clinical teams are in synchronized with this. We want to roll it out as a patient advocacy program so that patients, wherever they go, should be able to ask these questions and hopefully get better care and have happier lives. Six steps: limit the amount of information, slow, avoiding jargon, using pictures or models, using show me techniques, and encouraging questions. I think we spoke a little about empathy, so I'll just run through a quick few slides on empathy. Involves understandings, feelings, thoughts, wishes, and communicating. It fosters social emotional competence. The use of empathy has increased self-awareness, sensitive to customers and colleagues, and an increased chance of understanding others correctly. I think you're all aware of the patient safety goals. We used to have 6 goals, we now have 7 goals. And what is important is that 4 of them involve some level of communication. To identify correctly, improve effective communication, use communication alarms safely, and eliminate wrong site, wrong patient, wrong procedure, surgeries. think this is my last slide. This is from the JCI, which just showed root causes of sentinel events. And what is actually shocking is as simple a measure as communication has proved to be the third largest cause of a sentinel event in a healthcare setting. Any questions? Yeah, sure. Sorry?
Three essentials of the patient. Essential of the patients.
The questions, okay.
So, what is my problem? What is the next option? And what do I do? Fourth one, what obviously a patient will ask, what is the cost to the price? Is it not?
That is something that will come up in the Indian context. But this was an American study.
Yeah.
Okay, so a lot of it was in managed care or in the NHS where the cost doesn't come as a consideration or as a question to be asked. But these are the questions that they said. Then of course the root cause they looked at was from the patient advocacy. So the patient goes back completely educated about what was wrong with him or her.
Yeah.
And then went back and did everything correctly.
Okay, so
okay, what I am saying is that in India, unfortunately, a lot of our doctors and nurses don't really communicate.
That's right.
Okay. I will call it maybe at old, you're still going with the father syndrome or the God syndrome.
Yeah.
So we expect most patients to comply blindly with what we tell them to do. Okay. For the young generation, I think those days are over. And
yes.
This is something even when I was in Jaslok, has to tell a lot of people who were doing the DNB programs at that time, you know, that you now need to be more. In fact, I got two of my youngsters here somewhere. So we need to be more proactive in understanding this fact that what you say is not expected as gospel truth by your patient anymore. So you do need to spend a little more time. It does not mean a whole lot of time, but what I have generally seen is a few minutes extra can make a world of a difference, and even it even reduces complaints. In fact, in the cost factor, I found they are even more ready to pay up because you've explained things to them.
But here the major concern is the price or the cost.
Yes.
So patient go on hopping to one consultant or another consultant, whosoever it's cheaper.
So the advantage of this system is that when you explain why you are recommending something,
yes,
even if the cost is a little more,
okay.
Right. So what you've done is you made the whole treatment process explained, you made it more transparent. So they're more willing to go with something because you explained why for this particular person, for this particular disease, this is possibly, in your opinion, the best method to do.
So a lot of training required by the health professionals.
Yes.
Health professionals. Thank you.
I think some colleges have actually started it. I know in AFMC they've actually started a module on patient communication. So I think as maybe that's one of the future things that should be done in every college. Yeah, sure.
Not marketing, but this year we are starting a postgraduate diploma in health communications.
Okay, great.
In our own school. Thank you.
And Laji, I just want to emphasize what you said is 100% correct. And I would advise all the young or not so young people in this audience that I have never attended an ICU counseling session where the doctors have not communicated in a language which we call medicalese. Terms like ventricular failure, acute left ventricular failure, congestive cardiac failure, pulmonary hypertension are thrown around by the doctors in the ICU. You know, patient is very critical. There's a very grave prognosis. No one knows what prognosis means, etc. So point to my question is this, my comment is that I feel young administrators should actually physically attend ICU counseling sessions. They'll be shocked to see what they hear. I repeat, I have not heard a single session in my life for last 19 years, which I could feel gets 8 out of 10 marks. They all feel the doctors are very highly qualified. What am I going to do over there? All ICU counseling sessions are full of medical jargon. It is sad, it is terrible, but it is also true. Thank you.
That is something that is there. I'll say bright spots in the dark cloud. There are a certain people who really do this very well. And I mean, very frankly, I've seen people in Jaslok, in SHN, even in Asian Art Institute, where things were, where they have very specific timings where the consultant comes down and explains. Obviously, yes, there is a certain gap between some consultant to some consultant, but there are people there who really explain very well. And like I said, it reduces a lot of things. People actually stop complaining and they agree to treatment modalities once they explain and they understand. Yeah.
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Jasmine from Ludhiana. I totally agree with what you said, that giving little extra few minutes to what patients wants to actually tell you about his or her problem, it really works. Because I started my clinic almost 10 years back. So what I did as a USP, I actually gave enough time to the patient to talk to me, to address each and every thing. And rather it is good for the doctors as well, because in that case, when we give enough time to the patient to tell his or her problem, actually we get to the root cause of the problem. So giving that extra few minutes to the patient really works. And I, myself only, give the follow-ups, and that a follow-up call from a doctor side, that really, I think, the patient feel more connected to the doctor.
See, like I said, 30 years ago, when I first graduated, I got posted to Jalandhar. Like I said, we used to try and do, we used to have OPDs of 200 plus. And, you wanted to finish that list as quickly as possible. So like I said, the minute somebody came, mostly chronic patients, you made them open their mouth. By the time they closed it, the prescription was ready and the next person was there. We were doing 30 seconds per patient. We had a senior pediatrician. In fact, I have met a lot of great pediatricians. He actually spoke a lot of things, including to the fact that he says, when you're prescribing something for a patient, you should even know how the syrups taste. So we have tasted syrups, and actually even, especially with the slightly older kids, and you ask them, what flavor fruit do you like? And he says, I like banana flavor. We say, okay, banana flavor, in those days, Ceptran syrup used to be banana flavored. So we used to give the kid banana syrup. It made a lot of difference, and it didn't really increase our consulting time. Yeah.
Thank you for the nice talk. You cannot overemphasize this. This is huge, the communication problems.
True.
And there are two parts of that. One is doctor-patient, and two things we do is, you, particularly when it's a difficult treatment or something like that, you get it answered back from the patient. Yes. What did I say? Kind of thing.
Yeah.
Second thing we give after every patient we see, we give them after visit summary. That means it's all written for them.
Yes.
Which is, I'm sure it'll come to India, or it's already happening.
It's already there. It's given.
And the second thing is, it's not just doctor-patient communications. It's doctor-doctor communication, doctor-nurse communication, which is also huge, particularly because of the shifts in the hospital or in the ICU. The things do get dropped.
Yes.
Like sign-off is the huge another thing that we train our junior physicians about, that, or doctor-nurse communication, particularly when the medications are being handed over. But I mean, this is a huge issue causing problems, and probably low-hanging fruit to be corrected.
Very true. Very true. For India, actually, this is one place I feel that IT and EMRs is something that can really address this. With EMRs, unfortunately, a lot that I've seen are extremely text-based. And any text-based system is likely to have a lot of information not written completely, or very often written in with abbreviations, which there's always going to be someone who doesn't understand it. There are some good EMRs. Dr. Budaraja, who spoke earlier, he was with Cerna. And I've seen a couple like Epic and even some couple of ones which Indian companies have, in RioMed, which is Pune-based, and Plus 91, which is again a Pune-based company. So I think that will come there. We will get there. Possibly in the next 10 years, I think that will reduce. The other thing is, with NUH accreditation now becoming the norm, this is something that particularly the younger generation is going to, it's more likely going to be forced upon them. That communication handovers, because you now have a document for handing over. And Yeah, it's something that is important. And I mean, actually, the studies do show that even just simple things like communicating of lab results have shown significant morbidities and lack of treatment provision.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful insight on the topic. I request Dr. Samita Jadhav, Deputy Director, Symbiosis Institute of Health Sciences, to kindly felicitate Dr. Colonel Ajay Gangoli, sir.